that was a message in itself. It was. Listen, I don't even have to preach now. Amen. I can sing your own happy right there. Because it is not that you're not going to go through something, but don't stop. Just keep going. Would you encourage somebody just to keep on going through? Keep on going through. Just to encourage somebody by and say, you're still here, you're still here. Amen. Amen. Woo! That was all right. Glory. Are you ready for the word today? Right quick, turn, if you will, to the Gospel according to St. Luke, the 15th chapter. A very familiar passage of scripture. Let's look at verse number 12. When you dance, I have his word. Well, verse 11. And he said unto them, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself, watch this, to a citizen of that country, and that him, that citizen, sent him into the field to feed swine. And when he would have fainted, have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many servants of my father's have bread enough to spare? And I'm out here starving to death. I'm going to get up and go home. And I will tell my father, Father, I messed up against heaven and against you. I'm not even worthy to be called your son. I tell you what, Daddy, make me a servant. And he got up and he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great ways off, his father saw him and had compassion on, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and again and in thy sight, and I am no more to be worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, watch this, bring forth the best robe, put it on my son. As a matter of fact, go get my ring and put my ring on his hand. Get the boy some good shoes and put it on his feet. As a matter of fact, let's throw a party. Get a big fat calf. And let's all eat and be merry. Pastor, what a celebration. Because my son that was dead is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. I want to take a few liberties this morning, if y'all don't mind, and I want to use this for a subject. You can learn a lot from a dummy. This morning, don't look at nobody, because the person you tell might be offended. But just repeat these words. Just say, you can learn a lot from a dummy. today, I pray that you would unveil, reveal your word, Father. Give us a revelation of what you're trying to tell us on this morning. I thank you, Father, even now in advance, that my mind is clear, my body is strong, and that I'm open to see and to hear what you want to show us today by your word. I bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may have a seat in the presence of the Lord. Now that you are awake, I figured, Brother Ranger, if I bring something real catchy, real funny, they would wake up before I got started preaching. But how many of you all recall in the 90s when the car manufacturers came out with a commercial that was designed to show the public what kind of damage could be caused to the human body as a result of not wearing a seatbelt? And I thought this was a brilliant idea, because if you saw the speed where which they would run those cars into those walls, I begin to think that if someone was actually in that car, then they would occur more damage trying to prove a point. But the manufacturers, you all have the wherewithal to place dummies in the car. One of the things I noticed, Mr. T, was that they put monitors and wires all over the dummy. Because they wanted to show what parts of the body would jump and be jolted back and forth on impact. And when the dummy would hit the wall, the registers would begin to read the amount of force, the PSI, of a car going about 65 to 80 miles an hour and coming to a head-on collision. Now, what happened was, even though the car generally was totaled and the dummy occurred much damage to the dummy, many lives were spared because they learned a lot from the dummy. Heard somebody tell me, he's going somewhere. Whether you know it or not, you can learn a lot from a dummy. The other day, I was in a car with a young man, and I was trying to give him some driving pointers. You know. Y'all look at me. And Donna, you know, these new school kids don't want to learn nothing. They oftentimes, Little George, think they know everything. You tell them to brake. When a car breaks, they tell you, I got room. I'll brake when I'm 2 feet from the car. You tell them, don't go over the speed limit. They tell you, why not? I can go 5 over. And so I'm trying to tell this young man, give him some pointers, Brother Paul, on how to drive. And so I could look in his face, Mr. Karen, and tell that I was frustrating him.
All right.
Y'all ain't feeling me yet. And so, Pastor Marsh, I proceeded to say, I said, when you get your children, you're going to do the very same thing I'm telling you. Well, Sharon, he gave me an emphatic, no way. He said, ain't no way in the world I'm going to tell my kids how to drive. And why did he tell me that? Right away, I said, that's what's wrong with the children today. Our kids are raising themselves because there is no parents to teach them how to get along in life. And many of our children, our young folk, have allowed the spirit of rebellion to creep into their lives and cause them to reject sound doctrine. The Bible is clear when you read the book of Proverbs. It says, son, despise, watch this now, despise not wise instruction. We are in a season, family, where our young people are rejecting sound instruction. As a matter of fact, I'll go one step deeper. They find it easier to embrace the thoughts of a fool than to embrace sound instruction. Oh, I'm going to help somebody in a few minutes. One of the reasons you allow children to have gone buck wild is because of their refusal to adhere to the voice of a good father. Now, I know sometimes our sisters say that all men are dogs, but I came to serve notice on every sister, not all men are dogs. Just the ones you hooked up with are dogs. Not all men are dogs. Dude. There are a few good men left. Pastor, how you doing? I'm one of them. And the men in this house, I prophesy, are one of them. Now, many of you not just say, I'm Pastor, I receive the word of prophecy. I'm going to be. I'm working on it. That's tonight's sermon. It's tonight's sermon. Holy thought. But let me tell you, watch this. Let me tell you what our government has found out. Because we are a statistic-driven society. And statistics don't lie. Here's what I found out, that 63% of our young folk commit suicide because there is not a father in the home to give instruction. 90% of our children are either homeless or run away from home because there was not a father in the house to give instruction. 85% of all children exhibit behavioral disorders that came as a result of a father not being in the house to give good wisdom. That's a bad thing, isn't it? Watch this. 71% of all high school dropouts have come because there was not a father in the house to give sound instruction. Can I go deeper here? 75%, watch this, of our children are suffering right now from chemical abuse or drug abuse because there was not a father in the house to give that child sound instruction. 70%, y'all, this is alarming, 70% of our young people right now are locked up in a state institution because there was no father in the house to help lead this child with sound instruction. Can I go one more, then I'll move on. 85% of our youth, with 65% are black men, are sitting in jail right now. Somebody say right now. They're sitting in jail right now because there was no father in the house to give them sound instruction. Understand, family, if there is not a man or a woman in the house to give sound instruction, we leave our children to raise themselves. And here is the bad part about leaving a child to raise themselves. Those children end up having children. And if the one who is giving the instruction is a dummy, you can't teach what you don't. You ain't talking back to me. See, I know, like many of my young children, I have one parent, but when I was coming, I had parents as well. And I have folks who stood in the gap to become surrogate parents. But if you all did like I did, I know that when they're talking, in your mind, you're saying, I really wish you would just shut up. Besides, anybody been there? And here, as a parent, what frustrates me, Brother Rice, the most is when I'm trying to give sound instruction and the child tells me, I already know. If you really want to make me itch as a parent, tell me you already know, but don't exemplify what you're telling me that you know. Because here is my reality. If you knew better, common sense would tell me you would do better. But to know better and not do better would tell me you might be a... Ooh, ask the person by saying, are we sitting by some dummies around here? I can ask you ahead. Oh, just the person by says, get ready to get real tight. Because I have learned that you can learn a lot from a dummy. One of the things I have learned in my life, Auntie, is watch this. If I see you go into a hole and you go into a ditch, it does not take rocket science to see the hole. I ain't gotta be spiritual. I ain't gotta speak in tongues. I ain't gotta be full of the Holy Ghost. I ain't gotta shout in the manna. I ain't gotta EKOC. I ain't gotta have a blah blah blah. I can see you in the hole. And if I see you in the hole, Brother Red, I got enough common sense to know that if the hole caught you, it'll catch me. Oh, y'all ain't telling me, don't worry, I ain't got the good part yet. But isn't it amazing that this is the thought process, y'all, of most believers? We always, sometimes we have been, we act like many people who suffer from substance abuse. Pastor, what you're saying, all of them at one point thought it would not catch me. All of them at some point thought, I'm going to try it one time just to see what it was like. The problem is, what they don't understand is that there is something inside the narcotic that is designed to become habit forming. And now what you once carried around is now carrying you. The one thing that used to be a chimpanzee is now a King Kong on your back. Come on, can I get a few real saints who can testify that there are some things I did one time in my life and I thought I had everything under control, and when I looked up, I couldn't shake that. Maybe y'all, it's just me. Anybody ever had a habit you just couldn't shake? And listen, family, I don't have to try something if you try. Because if it messes up your life, I believe it'll mess up mine. If it jacked up your life and your mind, I believe it will mess up mine. But I have good news for you. You can still learn a lot from a dummy. When I look at this lesson, I see quite a few lessons, you all, that we can learn. Because in the Bible, there's some things that I saw from some of God's prominent people that made dumb decisions. Come on, beside me, anybody know you made a dumb decision? Or I know maybe the person might have been spiritual their whole life, but touch the person on the other side, them say they should put their hand up. Everybody in this place, at some point in your life, you have made a decision that you regret. You'd be surprised why some folk are crying and hollering on the altar. Everybody crying on the altar ain't crying for a breakthrough. Some folk crying and Lord, please keep that under the blood. Come on, anybody got some stuff you pray that don't nobody ever find? Maybe it's just me. All of us got some stuff we pray that God don't let nobody ever find out I ever did that. Because we have mastered the art of hiding the back. Hallelujah, Lord. Because you know, about to go there. But when I look in the book, in the scripture, I've seen some of God's generals that all of you are aware of, that when I see their dumb decision taught me something. Pastor, what do you mean? When I look at Adam's life, I learned from Adam that you can't eat everything they give you. There are some folk that's giving you stuff, man, feeding you stuff, that is jacking you up from the floor. And Adam got his life messed up. Adam messed up all mankind because Adam did not obey God and he ate what somebody gave him. Look here, when I look at Abraham, I learned from Abraham, you can't sleep with the maid and expect to have good success. That's right. Oh, maybe I'll park and get quiet right there. You can't Just give your goodies out like it's a bag of tricks, baby. Somebody gonna give you some honeycomb. And have your life all turned upside down because you want to just give it to everybody who's got their hand out. Listen, Abraham got messed up for sleeping with the maid. Well, when I look here at Samson, I learned from Samson that you can go blind trying to hang out with those folks who ain't loyal. Pastor, what do you mean? You know Samson, he hung out with this girl that God told him, obviously, don't hang out with. Isn't it amazing how we fall in love with the folk we know ain't no good? Oh, maybe I'm in the house by myself. I know besides me, somebody done hooked up with some folk you know wasn't no good for you. The Holy Ghost told you, let that Negro alone. You said, no, God, you don't see God. Look at him. God, he looked good, and then he got old. You found out that this homeboy didn't just have you, he had you and Tim on the side just like you. Come on. And so when I looked at Samson, I realized, listen, you can't hang out with folks who ain't loyal. You can't just tell folk the secrets of your heart, because folk don't keep secrets, baby. Oh, y'all ain't talking about me. I said, folk don't keep secrets. You tell folk, I'm going to tell you something now. Don't tell nobody. And they say, yeah, but as soon as you leave, they can't wait to tell somebody what you told them, because folk really ain't loyal. Oh, the person might say, oh, are you really loyal? Are you really loyal? Then I began to look over here at Joseph. See, I learned a lot from Joseph. See, Joseph said, Pastor Larry, if you want to learn something, learn this. Even if you run, you still look guilty. You know how my girl, Miss Potiphar, she seen Joseph and she seen this boy. And she said, oh, that boy look real good. Sam, she tell her, get the boy hit him up in the closet. This is why I encourage our brothers, listen, don't let nobody hit you up in the closet. That's right. Because folk will ruin your reputation even over a lie. Y'all ain't talking back to me. I was talking to a preacher the other day. I said, listen, even if they tell a lie, it will still damage your life. Because people are prone to believe a lie before they believe the truth. And I don't care, you can do 10,000 good things in one lie would have gained every good thing you ever did. And even if you are not guilty, people will believe the lie over the truth. Pastor, how do you know? The Bible said that in the last day, they will believe a lie. Oh, somebody shout and say, you can learn a lot from a dummy. When I look here in our text, we see here this young man who found himself distracted. Anybody ever got distracted? This young man found himself distracted. Because watch this, before the man came to his father and asked his father for anything, watch this now, something had to shift his thinking from being comfortable in the house to make him believe that there was more outside the house than the provisions in the house. Now, don't miss this, family. This is the same way the devil would do God's children. He will convince us that the grass is greener on the other side. But he won't tell us the reason it's not growing is because it's astroturf. Because many times we all, here's our reality. Sometimes, most of the time, well, almost all the time, it looks like doing things the world's way is better. All right. I guarantee you, if I do a survey right now, a lot of us still love to dance. All right. Don't raise your hand. A lot of us still love to get to the club. If we thought that God would forgive us, we go to the club every night. All right. Okay, I'm sorry. I'll talk about pastor because y'all can't. And if y'all do to me. If I thought God wouldn't get me, I'd go to the club. Trick that quiet. Yeah, I would. I sure would. I'd break it up. I would show you how to dance for real. If you thought God would get you, some of y'all would still get you a little hit every now and then. I you thought God wouldn't get you, you would still get you a little nip nip every now and then. Because watch this. Oh, somebody over there really getting over there. Over there, get a flashback. I don't even want to know what that was. Look at me. Come on, if you thought God wouldn't get you, you would still sleep around more than you do now. Oh, Justin Bantam says you're going to learn a lot from a dummy. But watch this. God has told us that if in our lives we are really going to be changed, watch this family, change does not start because you get saved. Change takes place when a believer makes up in their mind that they are tired of doing life the same old way. And many of God's people, we are changed in our spirit man, but we still want to do the same old things we used to do. But understand, you cannot prosper in the kingdom of God's system still walking in the world's system. Are you following me? This young man saw something in the world that caught his attention. This is why you can't give too much time looking at things that catch your eye, that you know shouldn't catch your eye. Why? Because many of us have been guilty of having the Adam syndrome. What do you mean the Adam syndrome? Where the very thing God tells us to not do becomes more attractive. Watch this, Pastor, what do you mean? Most of us have the tendency to bypass those things which are good for us and embrace the very thing which is not good for us. Okay, let me start with your appetite. Most of us like eating junk. All right, but sadly, all the junk eaters, come on, raise your hand. When they tell us to eat the good stuff, eat fruit, eat vegetables, I don't ever see a long line in the vegetable aisle. I guarantee you, you won't ever see the parking lot full at the health food store. Come on, I ain't never seen Whole Foods say we out of food. But you might go to church by Popeyes today and they say, well, gotta hang tight, we gotta make some more chicken. Because we have this proclivity to lean toward bad rather than something good. Watch this. God told Adam, he says, you may, watch this glass, you may eat freely, Dottie, from every tree in the garden. He said, but of a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, don't miss this. Adam could have eaten from a tree of life. It was in the garden. Watch this. I guarantee you it was close to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. How come he didn't eat from the other trees, but the one that God said don't eat from, that's the one that looked good? Y'all quiet, because you know I'm going someplace. I'm coming right down your road right now. We all know when something is attracting us that we know is not good for us. This is why I always say it is hard for a Christian to stumble into sin. If I stumble into sin, you have to like hit me and make me shoot you. Then I stumble. But watch this, Pastor, why you say it's hard to stumble into sin? Because if I'm going to sin, there is so much time between initiation and preparation. Y'all come on, I keep you above water. Don't make me go there. I got too much time between here and there to change my mind, to consider what I'm getting ready to do. So when I do it,